So I want just to start by answering this question about the Lorentz group as SL2C. Let me tell you when this kind of relation are true for other cases. So I will do the case of the of SO31, of SO31, SO3, and then in four dimensions, these are the three relevant cases because this is the Lorentz group, this is the rotation group, and this is the conformal group. And then I will consider other cases where the dimension allows this kind of relation. This has to do with the fact that if the dimension is not too high, in this classification of Lie algebras A, B, C, D, some of this object overlap when the dimension is sufficiently small. And the case of the Lorentz group is an example because SL2C, because SL2C and SO31 are in different series of the ABCD classification, and the same is true for SO3 and SU2. So what is true is that SL2C is so-called, mathematically speaking, is a simply connected group which is related to the Lorentz group. Now, the simply connected group of the Lorentz group coincide also with what is called the universal covering group. The universal covering group is a group which has the property of being simply connected. For any group which is not simply connected, there is a unique universal covering group, and this is the simply connected group which has the same Lie algebra of the original group. So in the case of SL2C, SL2C has the same Lie algebra of SO31. You can write the generator of one in terms of generator of the other as linear combination, but if you look at the group as a topological space, the SL2C group is simply connected while the SO3 group is not simply connected. And then I show you, because of this relation 2 to 1, but what is true in general, this is a mathematical result, is that if you take the orthogonal group, the orthogonal group have a very particular property because they have associated a Clifford algebra, which is the Clifford algebra of the orthogonal group. So orthogonal group have an associated Clifford algebra. The Clifford algebra is the algebra of gamma matrices which satisfy this property. For D even, this Clifford algebra has dimension 2 power D, and for D odd as D even, and for D odd as dimension 2 power D minus 1. And this Clifford algebra is realized in a space where these are matrices in this linear space. And the linear space in which the Clifford algebra is realized is called the Spinor representation. So the Spinor representation is the linear space in which the Clifford algebra gamma matrices is realized. So to make the simplest example, let's do the thing which we are familiar with, which is the D equal 4 Clifford algebra. The D equal 4 Clifford algebra, what are these elements, 2 power D elements? Well, these 2 power D elements are 1, gamma 5, gamma mu, gamma mu, gamma 5, and gamma mu nu, antisymmetric. You see, if you count these matrices, you get 1, 1, 4, 4, 6. So you get 16. So you see, this 16 is 2 power d, which is 2 power 4 equals 16. So the number of gamma matrices, the basis of gamma matrices is this 2 power d. The space, the spinor representation has a dimension 2 power d over 2, if d is even, and 2 power d minus 1 over 2 if d is odd. So in the case of 4 dimension, 2 power d over 2 is 4, which is the dimension of a spinor in 4 dimension. But this number, this is dimension independent. Now, I will come to the Clifford algebra and the role of this thing in supersymmetry very soon, when I will discuss multiplets. You have seen that I was talking before about gravity multiplet, number of scalar. I want to show you how you find this number from first principle. But for the moment, let me just say that since a supersymmetry multiplet contains spinor and bosons and fermion, and one consequence of the supersymmetry is that the multiplet of bosons and fermion contains same number of bosons and fermion, this I will show you why, then of course the multiplet will be very much dimension independent, because dimension dependent, because the dimension of a spinor grow exponentially while the dimension of a boson grows polynomially, because the tensor field of bosons have a dimension. For instance, a vector is linear in the dimension, a tensor is quadratic in the dimension, the number of components, so on. So since spinor grow exponentially and the boson grow only polynomially, if you want to have a number, equal number of bosons and fermion, is almost a miracle. I mean, you must have a very particular arrangement, and this is one of the consequences of this, is that if you exceed 11 dimension, what happens is that your multiplet has higher spin particle other than the graviton. It has a particle with spin bigger than 2. Massless particle with spin bigger than 2, and that is one of the reasons why one thinks that there is a barrier at 11 dimension with supergravity, or in the framework of string theory, what is called M-theory. Why there is no M-theory in 12 dimension and 13 dimension? There is not, because the multiplet, the basic multiplet of particle, these algebras have higher spin particle which are massless in Minkowski space and which you don't know how to write interactions. So this analysis of the representation of supersymmetry for any d, in particular the barrier d equal 11, was actually in a famous paper of Werner Nam, nuclear physics paper of Werner Nam, where he found this 11 bound of 11 dimension for theories which have up to the gravity multiplet as a number of massless multiplets. Well, here I want to come back for this thing. This relation between SO31 with SL2C is very convenient, because it allows to use a simplification, because instead of using the orthogonal group, you use this two-dimensional group, which is SL2C. Now, if you ask me when there are this kind of relation, I can tell you what is the relation. If the Lorentz group, it has the same relation in three dimension, because this group is the spin group of this group is SL2R. Then there is in five dimension, there is a similar thing, because SO41, the spin group is USP 2,2. Well, you can see this because if two non-compact groups have the same dimension and they have the same maximal subalgebra, they must coincide. And you see the SO41 has SO4 as maximal compact subalgebra, and this has USP 2 cross USP 2, but this group coincide. USP 2 cross USP 2 is the same of SO4, because SO4 is SU2 cross SU2, and SU2 is the same as USP2. Then in SO5,1, this is isomorphic to SU star 4. And this again, you see, because these two groups are the same, because the maximal compass of group coincide. In this case, is SO5. In this case, is USP4, but SO5 and USP4 are actually the same group. So these are these cases where the ABCD series have some groups in common. So you see the spin group of this Lorentz group in dimension 5, 2 and 3, in 3 is SL2C, are all classical groups. And there is now this is for the Lorentz group. For a rotation group, there is a similar story. SO3 is isomorphic to SU2, so SU2 is a spin group of SU3. SO4, SU2 cross SU2. SO5, USP4. So this, to say that these are equivalent means that the spin representation of this group is the fundamental representation of these other groups. You see, in these other groups, you cannot talk about spinor, because spinor is related to orthogonal groups. But what is true is that the fundamental representation of these groups coincide with the spinor representation of these groups. And this is the same here. So this is the, so SO5 is SUSP4 and SO6 is SU4. So you see the spinor of SO6 has dimension 4, complex dimension 4, and in SU4 is just the fundamental representation. This is the meaning of this. Like in the Lorentz group, the spinor representation of the Lorentz group in 4 dimensions is the fundamental representation of SL2C, which I showed you in my previous lectures. So all these homomorphisms are cases where the spin group is the simply connected component of the orthogonal group, is isomorphic to another classical group. Because if you go higher in dimension, the spin group, which is the simply connected which is the group which has the same Lie algebra orthogonal group, but is simply connected. The simply connected group is not a classical group. It's not a classical group. In all dimensions which are different from the one I gave here. But what is true that in any dimension, the spin group coincide with the universal covering group of the orthogonal group. So the universal covering group is the spin group, and the spin group is the connected component, is a simply connected group, was Lie algebra, is the same Lie algebra of the orthogonal group. There is a similar story for the conformal group. For the conformal group, I have the following. SO12 is the conformal group. It is SOD minus 2, SOD comma 2, for D equal 1. So it's the conformal group in one dimension. So this is isomorphic to SL2R. So it means that the spinor of SO12 is the doublet of SL2R. Then there is SO2,2. These are all the conformal group. You see, this is D equal 1, this is D equal 2. I mean, this is, of course, the finite part, because the conformal group in 2 dimensions is actually infinite dimensional. But this is the conformal group taken to be this group SO2,2. SO2,2 is SL2R cross SL2R. Then there is the conformal group in 3 dimensions, which is isomorphic to SP4R. And finally, there is a conformal group in 4 dimensions, the one we have discussed more previously, and this is isomorphic to SU2,2. Well, these groups will appear also in graded Lie algebras, which are at the of the basic of supersymmetry. And this relation are actually very closely related to the fact that simple superalgebras exist only in very particular case. For instance, if I ask, suppose I want to have a unification of supersymmetry with conformal symmetry. Well, if you want to unify supersymmetry with conformal symmetry, so you want to obtain what is usually called superconformal symmetry, because of all this connection, actually this is possible only in very, very limited cases. And if you look at this problem in D dimension, you find that the superconformal algebra can only be realized for D less or equal to 6. So there are no superconformal algebra which satisfy, defined in a certain way, for dimension, spacetime dimension D bigger than 6. They exist only for D less or equal to 6. And since I'm not doing two-dimensional, three-dimensional theory where there are superconformal algebra, this means that 4 and 5 and 6 are very special because they have superconformal algebras. For D bigger than 6, there are no superconformal algebras. If you use... yes. Excuse me? I'm going to show you what is the reason. Well, the reason is the following. Well, the assumption you do in when you do this classification of superconformal algebras is the application of the so-called Coleman-Mandula theorem. And the Coleman-Mandula theorem is telling you well, in fact, Coleman-Mandula theorem is essentially a statement that if you make certain assumption of the S-matrix, unitary S-matrix with a finite number of particles, and with particles limited in spin, the internal symmetry group of any theory must commute with the space-time symmetry group. So internal symmetry, G-internal, must commute. So the Lie algebra of the spacetime group, of the internal symmetry group, Lie algebra of G, must commute with the Lie algebra of spacetime. So it is impossible to have realization of a field theory where you have multiplet which realize a Lie algebra which contains a subgroup this but is bigger, namely that generator which link this quantum number to these quantum numbers. This is called the Coleman-Mandula theorem, and there is a generalization to supersymmetry of this theorem which is called the Haglo-Puchalski-Sonius theorem. If you are interested, I will give you the references. So the assumption in this construction I was telling you here has the following meaning. In a graded Lie algebra, which is also the same as superalgebra, you must assume that the bosonic part, so bosonic or even part, of the graded Lie algebra, has the property of being the product of a space-time symmetry cross an internal symmetry. Well, this is the strong assumption which allow to make the classification and for which, in fact, you get very restricted cases where this is true. So you see, the graded Lie algebra contains fermion in the odd part, the object which anticommute, and bosons in the even part. If the algebra, as I'm going to do, is simple or semi-simple, it is very restrictive, this fact of obtaining in the even part a product of groups, which is a space-time symmetry group, and and the internal symmetry. In fact, generically, this is never possible unless you can make the inverse state. There are various exceptional cases where this is possible. And this, of course, is possible when you can, it's not surprisingly that this is possible when there is a dynamic reason why this is happening. And this dynamic reason can be the IDS conformal field theory correspondent, can be string theory construction, can be Yamin's theory construction, but there is a basic reason why this is possible. And I will tell you, if you assume that the algebra is a simple or semi-simple gradedly algebra, the classification of this algebra was made by mathematician. Victor Katz from MIT is the major major contributor to this classification. And the classification tells you that, remember that we had in the case of Cartan algebra, we have this classical series. And then we have some exceptional cases. I will not talk about exceptional semi-simple Lie algebras. I will talk only on classical Lie algebras, which are the generalization of this series here. The other exists only in particular dimension, and I will just tell you one case which is relevant of physics. So what is happening is that the graded Lie algebra construction or the super algebra construction link together two bosonic Lie algebra group, two bosonic groups. So essentially this graded Lie algebra, when they are simple, are made by the bosonic part, which is a pair of Lie groups, and the fermionic part, which is a representation of this pair of Lie groups. So let me just make the simplest case. The simplest case is the so-called orthosymplectic graded Lie algebra. Graded Lie algebras, because actually there are infinite of them, exactly like there are infinite algebras of this classical type ABCD. Well, the orthosymplectic Lie algebra has the property of having an even part. The name is the reason why it has this name. It has an orthogonal and a symplectic group. So the pair is an orthogonal group and a symplectic group. This is why it's called orthosymplectic. So the even part is the product. I'm writing this in the complex. Then the real form will come later, and there are restrictions on the real form. But let me tell you that the even part, now I write everything in the complex, the even part is SO N cross SP to M. So you see, this orthosymplectic Lie algebra must be specified by two numbers, N, and then I will call N slash M. So the even part is this thing. The odd part I have to specify. Well, the odd part is the fundamental representation of SON times the fundamental representation of SP to M. So the odd part is like that. This means that is a vector under SON and is a fundamental representation under SP to M. So this is the, since this algebra exists for any value N and M, this is the generalization to supersymmetry, if you want, to graded Lie algebras of the classification, the Cartan classification. There are other isolated cases which I will not talk about, but these are the infinite classical series of there is another one which I have not written, and these are complete now. The other one, which is an infinite series, is the so-called unitary unitary graded Lie algebras, and they have bosonic part, which is a pair of of SUN groups times U1 if N is different from M. If N is equal to M, U1 become a central charge, and you have two different algebra, the one where the central charge is non-trivial, the one where the central charge is trivial, and that is called a projective. SUN/N algebra, and of course SU4 Yamin's theory is an example of this for n equal 4. So this projective group exists only when there is a central charge, but when n is different from m, this U1 is not a central charge, and so there is no projective group you can talk about. Now what is the, so you see, now you want to apply this thing to physics. So if you want to apply this to physics, well, you have to assume that this product is precisely the Coleman-Mandula theorem. So Coleman-Mandula theorem is telling you that the space-time symmetry group must be found in one of these factors, and the internal symmetry group by the on the complementary factor, because then this will satisfy the Coleman-Mandula theorem that the symmetry of your theory is the product of an internal symmetry times a space-time symmetry. Of course, we are interested in non-compact form of this because the space-time symmetry is non-compact. And let me, I will not give you the classification. This actually you can find in a review of Van Prooyen. I can give, but there are several real forms of this orthosymplectic algebra. But one, two which are important are the following. SON cross SP for SP 2MR. So this means that the form has the compact orthogonal group in one side and the non-compact symplectic group in this side, because the symplectic group of the real form of the symplectic group is actually non-compact. And now here you see something interesting, which is related to the analysis I was doing before. If n, if m is 2, this becomes SP4R. And if you look here, SP4R is SO3,2. And SO3,2 is the conformal group in three dimension. Or if you want the anti-de Sitter group in four dimension, depending whether you use this as a conformal theory or in a IDS background. But in any case, this is telling you that when the space-time symmetry is SO3,2, there is a Gödel-Li algebra, and this N is the internal symmetry. So this is nothing but the superconformal algebra in three dimension, which has R-symmetry SON, unlike four dimension when the R-symmetry is UN. In four dimension, the superconformal algebra has SON symmetry. And because this form belongs to this to certain non-compact form of this series, you see that this satisfies all the property I wanted to have. So this is telling you that in three dimension, superconformal algebra exists for n extended supersymmetry. This n is the n extended, because you see the fermionic charges will be the 4 of SP4R. From that analysis, and it will be the n of SON. So this is precisely the object which enter in the supersymmetry algebra. These are the supercharges, are the fermionic supercharges, and the generator of this group are the bosonic supercharges. So this is nothing but the group theoretical realization of the three-dimensional superconformal algebra, which has group SO3,2 and R symmetry group SON. So this algebra appear in other conformal theory. In fact, so we have seen that then the superconformal algebra in D equal 3 has a nice realization for all extended supersymmetries. Even for extended supersymmetry for which you don't know how to write the Lagrangian, because this algebra exists for n arbitrary. Now it's clear if n goes too high, you exceed this bound of, on the multiplet. But I mean, from an abstract algebra, this exists for any n. So the superconformal algebra in three dimensions exists with any extension. Extension in meaning the number of spinor charges. Well, this algebra has actually its fate also in six dimension, where the role of the two groups get interchanged. Namely, in six dimension, you take as internal symmetry the symplectic group, and as a space-time symmetry the orthogonal group. So how this is possible? Well, we will see that this is possible because the famous, what is called SO8 triality. SO8 triality is a symmetry of the orthogonal group in a dimension which has three representations which are triality related, namely they can be interchanged. And these are the vector representation of SO8 and the spinor representation, which are, there are two spinor representations, and the triality is a symmetry which comes permuting this three representation. This actually is also a basic property of 10-dimensional strings. It plays a dramatic role in 10-dimensional string because SO8 is the little group of a massless particle in 10-dimension. But here, this triality comes about because there is another non-compact form of this group where SON is non-compact and SP2MR is compact. And this is why the role of space-time symmetry and internal symmetry are interchanged. This is exactly what happened in six dimension. So in six dimension, the superconformal algebra is of the same type of three dimension, is an orthosymplectic algebra, but where the role of space-time symmetry, internal symmetry is flipped with respect to the three dimensional case. In fact, this group become SP, USP, 2M. So the group which was before non-compact, now is compact. And the group which before was compact, now you take a non-compact form. So this SON, you take instead SO star 2N. This is a non-compact form of this graded Lie algebra, the reason why there are these non-compact forms is due to mathematician, has to do with the reality property of spinor, but this is very similar to the non-compact form which exists for the ABCD classification. I didn't tell you how this compact form, non-compact form are obtained, I just gave you the result. Now here, what I can tell you is that there is a non-compact form of the orthosymplectic algebra of this type. Now, what is happening now, the miracle, is that SO star 8 is actually isomorphic to SO 6,2. So you see that there are two facts. The SO star 8 is one of these star groups, which for this particular case of 8 dimension, is actually the same non-compact form of SO 6,2, and SO 6,2 is the conformal group in 6 dimension. Because that is the definition of the conformal group. And also, because of this triality, in the orthosymplectic algebra, instead of taking a vector, I take a spinor of SO2, namely I exchange the 8-dimensional representation. And then you see that I realize that this object becomes, so only for n equal 4, only for n equal, well, for n equal 4, let me do for n equal 4. For n equal 4, I get SO6,2 cross USP4. For n equal 4, and m equal 2. Now, this is the bosonic part of the superconformal algebra in six dimension when you have 2,0 supersymmetry. Probably many of you don't know this classification, but there is a supersymmetry algebra in four dimension which is called 2,0, Excuse me? In six dimensions. Yes. Six dimensions. No, no, in six dimensions. I'm talking about six dimensions. In fact, there are two supersymmetry algebra, which are super conformal algebra in six dimensions, 2,0 and 1,0 algebra. These two algebras are symmetry USP4, I will show you why later, and USP2 in this case, which is the same as SU2. You see, this USP4 and this USP2 are simply SO star 8 and SO star 4. The fermion are in the eight dimension are in the fundamental representation of this USP, the charges. So it's the fundamental representation. So what I'm just saying is that this is the bosonic part of the superconformal algebra, so the fermion will be octet under SO 6,2 and in this case quadruplet with respect to USP4. Because the superconformal algebra which are realized in physics, there are only two. There is a 1,0 and a 2,0. And this correspond to two values of M. Because this is the this actually is the R symmetry in six dimension. The R symmetry in six dimension for the 2,0 USP4, and this is why I take M equal to, and the 1,0 is USP2, and this is why. So this algebra realized in physics only if M is 2 and 1. And I realize for N equal to and 4. So you see that in six dimensions, the role of the orthogonal group and the symplectic group are interchanged. In three dimensions, the symplectic group was the space-time part, and the orthogonal group was the R-symmetry part. Here is the other way around. The R-symmetry group is the symplectic group, and the space-time symmetry part is a non-compact form of this orthogonal group. Well, it is a mathematical fact that there are no other superconformal algebras which have the property of, as I said, you that having a bosonic part which is the product of the conformal group and internal symmetry, and which have a super extension. This algebra do not exist. It's a mathematical fact. So, and that is the reason why the superconformal algebra can be realized only up to D equals six dimension, because it's only up to six dimension that you have this particular role of the two factor, one which can be a space-time symmetry and the other which can be an internal symmetry. So D equals six, N equal, well, 2,0 and 1,0 theory. And now D equal 4, what is the similar thing for D equal 4? For D equal 4 is a little bit simpler, and this I will show you in detail. In this case, the unitary series occur. Where this N is taken to 4 and correspond actually to a non-compact form which I call 2,2, because the unitary group is actually SU22. And this is why you see why it's related to the conformal group, because in four dimensions, SU22 is the spin group of SO42, which is the conformal group. So SU22 is telling you that you can use the unitary series, and then the R-symmetry becomes unitary. So there is this series contains as bosonic part SU22 cross SUM cross U1, for M different from 4, And you can have you can delete U1 factor only for n equal 4 where there is this projective representation, because the U1 charge become a central charge. So you can model out the central charge. And that is the symmetry, of course, of n equal 4 Yamils. N equal 4 Yamils is based on this algebra with m equal 4. So the projective algebra SU22/4, which probably you have seen in the literature, is the underlying superconformal algebra of n equal 4 Yamils. If you have instead n equal 1 supersymmetry, this factor is there and the R symmetry become UN. Essentially, this there is an intermediate case, which is the five-dimensional case. In the five-dimensional case, is one case where you can have a conformal symmetry, but then the underlying superalgebra is one of these exceptional superalgebras, which is actually called F4 superalgebra. I will not talk about this, but I mean there is a superconformal algebra also in five dimension, which is called F4 superalgebra, which is one of the exceptional simple gradedly algebra. I will not talk about five dimension. But the interesting fact is that in a four-dimensional case, this is actually the best Zumino superconformal algebra. First paper of Vess and Zumino, they wrote the algebra of this group, of course, in the case m equal 1, which is the case of n equal 1 supersymmetry. In n equal 1 supersymmetry, the superconformal algebra has a U1 R symmetry and an SU22 space-time symmetry, and you have two pair of charges, which are usually called Q alpha A and S alpha dot A. And if you pair this together, this object make actually a four-dimensional spinor of SU2, 2. And if you have a UN, you have URN here. So the spinor is the 4N of SU22 cross UN, and then there is the complex conjugate spinor, which is the 4 bar N bar. So this is the central the spinor part of the superconformal algebra in four dimension. So what is the, well, the role? The role is that you have an enhanced symmetry in any theory where you have this superconformal algebra, because the realization of superconformal algebra is much more stringent of realization of non-superconformal cases. If you have superconformal, I tell you that D must be less or equal to 6. If you have a Poincaré, then D can be much higher. The bound is D less or equal to 11. So these two bounds are related whether you are using in higher dimension Poincaré supersymmetry or superconformal symmetry in the dimension. Another property of the superconformal symmetry is that the superconformal symmetry has less charges if you regard it as a Poincaré symmetry, has half of the charges of the Poincaré symmetry. For instance, as twice as the charge of the Poincaré symmetry, and this is due to the fact that the spinor of SU22 is four-dimensional. So it's a pair of spinor of SL2C. If you think about SL2C, is made a pair of spinors. So the spinor charges of the superconformal algebra are twice the number of spinor charges of the Poincaré algebra. Since I talk about this algebra, but I never wrote them explicitly, let's just mention at the first step the n equal 1 Vess-Zumino super Poincaré algebra. Well, this is actually what appeared in the first paper of Vest and Zumino in 1974. Well, this algebra contains a single complex two-dimensional alpha. Is now I'm using these alpha dot indices which I introduced. So this Q alpha is a complex two-dimensional spinor charge, and the algebra has the following structure. Q, from the point of view of gradient algebra, is an odd generator, so it satisfies anti-commutation relation, and its anti-commutation relation is actually sigma mu alpha dot p mu, where p mu is a space-time translational momentum of your theory. Then Q alpha with P mu is zero. And then Q alpha with M mu nu is actually 1/2 sigma mu nu alpha beta Q beta. So you see that Q has the property of commuting with the P mu, and the two Q with the complex conjugate, let me put a bar here to denote complex conjugate, Q with the complex conjugate charge generate the translation. But P mu is an invariant subalgebra, and actually, for the same reason, the Poincaré group is non semisimple. Actually, the Vest-Zumino superalgebra is non semisimple, because the bosonic part is not semi-simple. Yes. Space I'm using here? D equal 4. Yeah, I'm telling you, I'm n equal 1 by Zumino, so it's four dimensional. Here is D equal 4, n equal 1. So the simplest case. Lowest dimension I'm discussing, and now minimal number of charges. In this case, Q alpha has two component complex, or if you want to write in a Majorana way, as four component real, you can write this in a different way. But for the thing I'm going to say now, it's better to use these two. The sigma mu alpha dot are actually the following matrices. The sigma mu alpha dot is actually 1 and then the Pauli matrices. And the gamma matrices can be written, if one wants the Vest-Zumino non-perverse conventions, gamma mu is I time sigma mu sigma bar mu, and sigma bar mu, well, sigma bar in the, sometimes we use the sigma prime, but I mean you can use sigma bar. Sigma bar mu alpha dot alpha is epsilon alpha beta epsilon alpha dot beta dot sigma mu alpha beta. There is this relation between epsilon and sigma. Well, this is a relation between two-dimensional and four-dimensional gamma matrices, but I'm telling you the reason why I spent some time to use these dotted and lotted indices is because with dotted and lotted indices, the algebra has a much simpler form. So this algebra is not contained in the classification I made before, because it's not a semi-simple gradedly algebra, because it has bosonic part which is not semi-simple, is the Poincaré group. In fact, strictly speaking, the Lorentz transformation are only outer isomorphism. You see, the M is never generated by the Q bar anticommutator. The M act only as a invariance of the algebra when you transform the Q as a spinor and the P mu as vector. But it doesn't appear actually. So this algebra as a subalgebra which is made only by the Q and P. Because if you take the Q and P and you commute and anticommute them, you never get M. So this Q and P is called sometimes it's called the super translation algebra, which is a subalgebra of the super Poincaré algebra. is a super quantum algebra where you don't take into account of the Lorentz transformation. Now let me remind you, of course, this algebra I can write for any n, and that is called extended Vezzomino superalgebra. If I put an index here, I forgot to write that q alpha I, q alpha dot j, q beta j is actually zero. So the q with q bar gives the translation, but the q with q gives zero. This is the Vezzomino superalgebra. So the, when you attach index I here, then the algebra has a manifest un symmetry. If that you transform the q's with the un and the q bar with the n bar representation. And the reason why this has a un symmetry is because this delta j is an invariant of un. So you see that if I write the extension in this way, this algebra has not only the Lorentz group as an outer isomorphism, but also un. And this un is usually called the R symmetry charge. So the R symmetry charge exists in both cases of Poincaré and conformal. The only difference is that in the case of conformal, the R symmetry charge appear also on the right hand side of anticommutator. And that is because of, like the mu nu, and that is because the algebra is semi-simple. When the algebra is semi-simple, which is the case of the superconformal algebra, there are anticommutators of the charges which generate all the bosonic commutator, and that is when you have the n extended superconformal algebra, which I'm not done up to this moment. So this is the extended Vezzomino Poincaré superalgebra. Well, of course, this algebra is the algebra which has milder restriction on the theory, and in fact, all theories in four dimensions which have been used so far are simply theories which are invariant under this algebra, either rigid in rigid supersymmetry or local in local supersymmetry. Any question? For M? What is NM? No, the Lorentz generator, I wrote only the other one is the commutation relation of the Poincaré group. So M and P are the usual commutation relation of the Poincaré group. When you introduce supersymmetry, M only appear in this anticommutator, in this commutator, and this is simply the statement that the Q are spinor under the Lorentz group. It's an obvious object. The thing which is not obvious is that this algebra is actually a Lie superalgebra, satisfy Jacobi identities. The Jacobi identities are satisfied, and the Jacobi identities do not put any restriction on these generators. So this algebra is the Vezzomino Poincaré superalgebra, actually Vezzomino did only for n equal 1, but this is extended with arbitrary number of Q charges. For reason I will specify later, in field theory, which is a non-trivial, with non-trivial dynamics, the number n is bounded to be less or equal to 8. So the number of this extension 1 up to n can be realized in field theory, either supergravity or rigid supersymmetry, only if n is less or equal to 8, and n equal 8 corresponds to the case where the number of charges are exactly 8 times 4 equal 32, And this number 32 appear also in the counting of charges in 11 dimensions. So depending, if you look from the point of view of different perspective, the thing which is dimension independent in the fact that you realize a supersymmetry algebra with a certain number of charges. And in 11 dimension, this number 32 appear again. This is the reason why you can go up to 11 dimension and no more, because otherwise the number of charges exceed 32 and you have higher spin state in your theory. This has to be shown. Well, in the case of Poincaré, which is not true in superconformal, but is true in super Poincaré, you have another algebra. And this other algebra is what is called the central extension of the super Poincaré algebra. So Hag, Lobunjanski, and Sonius generalize this algebra to a case which in fact is surprisingly is realized in field theory and is realized especially in supergravity. And this is the case where you add the central charges in the right hand side of this anticommutator which I wrote. You see that here I only added space-time charges. But in fact other than space-time charges I can introduce also other objects which are compatible with the Jacobian identity of the algebra, and that is called central extension of super Poincaré algebra. The central extension, there are many. The simplest one is what is called the Hag-Lobozhansky-Sonius algebra. And the Hag-Lobozhansky-Sonius algebra is a modification of this algebra only in this QQ commutator, anticommutator. So the QQ anticommutator which is zero in the Bezzomino super Poincaré algebra is non-zero in the Hag-Lobozhansky-Sonius superalgebra and is given by the following expression. So let me use here A and B instead of IJ. And you see that this object, since this object is symmetric, being an anticommutator, in the exchange alpha A with beta B, since here, by Lorentz symmetry, I have to put the epsilon tensor, which is antisymmetric in the spinor indices, I must have here an operator which is antisymmetric in A and B. So this object must be antisymmetric in A and B, otherwise it doesn't respect the anticommutation, the symmetry of the anticommutation. Well, you see that this is telling you immediately that for n equal 1, this term is absent, because for n equal 1, this object doesn't exist. But the first time it exists is for n equal 2. But for n equal 2, there is also another very simplification, which is that the antisymmetric representation of SU2 is simply the identity representation. So in n equal 2, this object is simply epsilon alpha beta epsilon ij times z. Or epsilon, in a way I wrote here, epsilon AB times Z. Because an antisymmetric 2 by 2 matrix can be written in this way. Well, this Z, non-vanishing, give what is called the central extension, well, is the simplest central extension of the N equal 2 or superconformal algebra. Hag, Lobozhansky, and Sonius wrote this algebra for any A and B, but for n equal 2 is particularly simple and it is given by that formula. This formula can be extended at any n in the following way. So this is the Haglund-Bucherski-Sonius superalgebra n equal 2. For n arbitrarily, you write this. But in fact, Haglund-Bucherski and Sonius made some assumption which can be evaded by a more general superalgebra. The assumption that Haglund-Bucherski and Sonius made is that the only physical excitation of your theory are point particles. If this is the case, then the result is that the only central extension you can have is this object here. Well, I forgot to say that ZAB has the following property. ZAB commute with the Q alpha, commute with the Lorentz generator, and commute with itself. From the Jacobian entities. So this is the reason why it's called a central extension, because this ZAB belongs by definition to the center of the algebra, because it commutes with everything. So ZAB is a central term in the Bez-Zumino superalgebra, independently of the number of A and B. And this is why actually the Jacobian entity of the algebra work. If this would not be true, the Jacobian entities would not close. And in fact, Haglund-Bucherski and Sonius made the thick paper to show that all the Jacobian entities are valid, and they imply this relation here. So this is the central extension of the super Poincaré algebra under the assumption that the only excitation are point-like objects. But this morning, Augusto Sagnotti was teaching to us that there are more general objects which are not point-like objects, but are extended objects. And this is what was missing Haglund-Bucherski-Sonius in their role, also because it's very hard to understand what is an S-matrix for extended object. It has to do with the string theory in the case of strings, but I mean, the assumption of Haglund-Bucherski-Sonius would not include the extended object among the objects that you are scattering. But from a mathematical point of view, extended objects actually correspond to central charges which are no longer scalar under the Poincaré group. You see that these central charges have no indices. So these are a bunch of scalar operators with respect to the Lorentz group. If you retain only the mathematical structure, which is justified by the fact that in a general theory there are not only point-like objects, but there are also extended objects, then the algebra is a much more general algebra. This much more general algebra, I think, at least I wrote a paper with Massimo Porrati on this. This is Physics Letters. B423, 1998, 255. So it's not a millennium paper, but it's near a millennium paper. It's two years before the millennium. So if you write, what is now this more general central extension? More general central extension is that you allow all the central charges which are compatible with the Jacobian entity. And then you find, not surprisingly, that there is a much more general algebra which has the following structure. Q alpha A, Q bar, alpha dot B, equal to sigma mu alpha alpha dot delta AB P mu plus sigma mu alpha alpha dot Z mu AB. Well, this is a central charge which has an index which has two indices, one in the N and one in the N bar representation of the R symmetry. You see, this term was not present before. And then the Q alpha Q beta, Q alpha A, Q beta B, equal to epsilon alpha beta ZAB plus sigma mu nu alpha beta Z mu nu AB symmetric. So this anti-commutator of left charges with left charges give, this is the term I had before, but give also another which is a tensor under the Lorentz group and has symmetric indices under UN. Well, this is the more general extended superconformal algebra in four dimensions. And the reason why it is the more general, you can count that the independent entries of these matrices are precisely saturated by all this operator. Well, the interesting fact is that this algebra exists, is non-trivial also for n equal. So what is the central? Central charge means that all this z, which I wrote there, commute with everything else. So x is any generator which appear here, including the z, and the z with them is zero everywhere. So the Jacobian entities of this algebra are fulfilled if all this z, both with the Lorentz indices and with the non-Lorentz indices, commute among themselves. So this is the most general extension of the superconformal algebra in four dimensions. You see that there is a term which already exists in n equal 1. In n equal 1, this term is non-zero. So this is telling you that the n equal 1 Vesdumino superalgebra has the following central extension, q alpha dot equal sigma mu nu sigma mu alpha alpha dot p mu. But then q alpha q beta is equal to sigma mu nu alpha beta z mu nu. Well, you see that this z mu nu is an antisymmetric tensor, but it's not a Lorentz generator because this object is a central object. So the z mu nu here has the property of commuting with the q and with the p and with the itself. So this object, if you think about the connection of central charges with the extended object, would correspond to what is called in the jargon of string theory to a membrane, because this is a two-dimensional charge, correspond to a two-dimensional extended object, and a two-dimensional extended object is a membrane. However, in four dimensions, the membrane is a peculiar object. In fact, the membrane is a domain wall, is a wall in your space-time. But in fact, there is there are papers, especially by Schiffman and collaborator, where they have a realization in theories, in Yamin's theories, in n equal 1, which have a non-trivial extension of this type. For my purpose, I want just to say that this is the n equal 1 superalgebra, and Vesdumino missed this term, because they were not thinking about including membrane in the game. They were doing a bona fide field theory with only particle, and then this term is absent. But this term, there are more complicated theories where this term appears in the is non-trivial in your theory. Chiore? Quanto c'è? Ah, sì. Let's do 5 minutes break and then we finish here. Well, I was just to finish this thing. By telling you that actually this algebra here and it will be the case also for an extended supersymmetry in other situation that this algebra is actually a contraction of a simple superalgebra. So the algebra in question is the n equal 1 case, this here. Well, the contraction comes because the following, the p mu and z mu, and z mu nu, are exactly number equal to the they are 10 generators. So they are precisely number equal to the generator of the conformal group in 3 dimension. In fact, what is happening is that if I take P and Z, not commuting, but satisfying the commutation relation of the SO3 group, then I will have this thing like this. Let me write first the commutation relation. Well, I don't write the explicit in the structure. I'm telling you only that M times M contains M. Well, these actually are the usual commutation relation of SO3 of the Lorentz part. But then I have that P with M is non-zero, and it makes P. Well, this also is true in the Lorentz group, but what is true in the anti de Sitter group, which is not true in the Lorentz group, is that P mu P nu, instead of being zero, is actually M mu nu. So if the structure of the Poincaré group is modified in this way, where PPP instead of commuting is equal to M mu nu, then this group become the SO3-2 algebra, which of course contains the SO3-1 algebra. And then there is for this algebra, fall in the classification I gave before. This is a particular case of the OSP 1/4 superalgebra, in fact. In the language I used before, so it means that the orthogonal part is completely absent. There is no R symmetry there. And the charges are the 4 of SP4R, which is the same of SO3-2. It's a spin representation of SO3-2. So the charges Q here, they will satisfy non-trivial Jacobian entities, because when P and Z do not commute, but they have this property, then the Jacobian entities are much more difficult to see that they are satisfied. But in fact, they are satisfied. So this central charge extension with the central charge Z mu nu, mathematically speaking, can be obtained by a contraction of a simple superalgebra to a non-simple one. Contraction means that I rescale the generator and I send some parameter to infinity in such a way that some commutator becomes zero. And you can see immediately which is the contraction. QQ and QQ bar give P and M. Suppose this is the orthosymplectic 1/4 superalgebra whose internal part is SP4R. SP4R are the M and P generator with non-commuting generator between P and itself. This thing here. Now you see that I can rescale M in R M tilde. P in 1 over R P tilde and Q in R 1/2 Q tilde. So if I rescale this thing, I get factor. I get factor in this algebra, except in a certain commutator. For instance, in this commutator, I don't get any factor because Q is the scale R 1/2, P is scale with R, so the R drops here. But in this commutator and also the commutator of Q with P, you will get a non-trivial dependence on R. And a non-trivial dependence is that when you have this tilde rescale with R, then you get in this object you get 1 over R factors, and this 1 over R factor as such that when R going to infinity, the object, some of the commutation which were non-zero before become zero now. And then this contraction is the statement that an extended central superalgebra of Poincaré group in some cases can be obtained by contraction of an algebra of this simple case which I wrote before. In this case, the statement is that the Bezzomino n equal 1 superalgebra with central extension is the contraction of the OSP 1 slash 4 superalgebra. So the contraction of this superalgebra gives you the Bezzomino superalgebra, Poincaré superalgebra, with the M mu nu which becomes central, which becomes Z mu nu. So the Lorentz generator is no longer the Lorentz generator because it commutes, but it becomes this central extension which I wrote before. So Poincaré superalgebra many times can be obtained as contraction of superconformal algebras. In the bosonic part, what of course must be the case is that the contraction of the simple bosonic part become a central extension of the even part of the superconformal group. So in the case of supersymmetry, the superalgebra are generators which are related to these Q charges. But if you want to introduce a supersymmetry transformation, you must introduce also the supersymmetry parameters, which are the parameter of the transformation. And this object you will call epsilon alpha A. They have the same number of the charges, but they have a funny property. These objects are not nor operator nor numbers, are Grassmann variable. Namely, this object have the property, this is the rule of the game, that they anticommute among themselves but they anticommute also with the Qs. Namely, the rule is that Q alpha A epsilon beta B is equal to minus epsilon beta B Q alpha A. So in order to work the structure, when you make computation, if you don't use this property, nothing work. I mean, these are the rule of the game. The rule of the game, which in fact are very hard to understand by mathematician, is that when you introduce the parameter space of this superalgebra, you introduce Grassmann variable which have the double property of commuting among themselves and commuting also with the operator of the supersymmetry generators. Now, if you forget, so you see, since the objects are anti-commuting, has no meaning to consider this epsilon a continuous number. For instance, what means a finite transformation and infinitesimal transformation, since this epsilon are not number? Well, what means for us an infinitesimal transformation is simply a transformation which keep epsilon, but not our power of epsilon. Even if, because in the Lie algebra, everything is obtained by taking the linear term in the parameter. So you do the same trick for anti-commuting variable. You take only linear term. So in some sense, a finite transformation would be like this. Now this object, because the epsilon commute, is actually a finite polynomial. It has only a finite number of terms. But I can define, irrespectively of the meaning of this epsilon, I can define a 1 plus epsilon a qa plus the rest, and keeping only this term. And that for me will be an infinitesimal supersymmetry transformation. I take the linear term in the finite transformation, which is an exponential. It's a fake exponential, because since the epsilon anti-commute, this object is actually a polynomial. It's not non-linear, it's a finite polynomial. Now, because of this rule, I can then derive the Noether theorem as I did for ordinary Lie group. So there is a Noether theorem if a group is substituted, or an ordinary Lie algebra is substituted with a graded Lie algebra, the supercurrent will have the same structure that he had in the Noether theorem. The only thing that you have to be careful in sign when you shift terms in the Lagrangian, because of this anti-commuting property of the parameter. Now, if you remember, I say that when you have an Noether current has an index mu and an index which is in the symmetry under which you compute the invariance of the Lagrangian. Well, since in our case, this index, let's do the case where A is L1, which is the N equal 1 superalgebra. In N equal 1, you have 1 Q alpha and you have 1 epsilon alpha. Alpha is a spinor index and epsilon is an anti-commuting number. So the infinitesimal generator, using the Noether procedure, is simply an object of this form. Epsilon bar alpha j mu alpha, because the Noether current must have an index, vector index mu, because it's a current, and must have another index in the Lie algebra part. Now, since in our Lie algebra part, the generator, our spinorial generator, this index alpha is transferred here. So we conclude that the supercurrent of supersymmetry is a vector spinor. You see, as an index mu, and an index alpha, so it's a vector spinor. This is something that you would find equivalently in Augusto notation if instead of doing two-dimensional theories with only boson, you do two-dimensional theory with only also fermion. Since in two dimensions, supergravity has no dynamical part, the equation of motion coming from the gravitino will give you the vanishing of the supercurrent, exactly like in the case of Augusto, the equation of motion of the metric were given the vanishing of the stress tensor. Here you get the vanishing of the supercurrent. I mean, if you do the two-dimensional string theory. Here, the stress tensor is not vanishing because we have gravity in four dimensions, so the supercurrent is not vanishing either. And the supersymmetry charge will be simply integral in d3x j0 alpha of x and t. And if j is conserved, q alpha of t will be independent of time, so it will be a constant of motion. And that is the statement that the theory is supersymmetric. A theory is supersymmetric if it has a Noether current, which is a vector spinor, and which is conserved. So the conservation of the current is d mu j mu alpha equals zero. So this means that your Lagrangian is invariant under supersymmetry transformation. So it is something that you can say without making any calculation, just some general principle. This is the definition, if you want, of a supersymmetric Lagrangian. A supersymmetric Lagrangian, not coupled to gravity, is a Lagrangian where there is a vector spin or current which is conserved. Now you can ask the similar thing that we had for the stress tensor. You remember the stress tensor needed improvement terms from the canonical one. The canonical one is the one you obtain with an Ether procedure. However, if you want to write all the generator of the algebra in terms of a single primary object, there is a supersymmetric version of that statement. In the superconformal algebra, let me remind you that the object which was important was what is called the improved energy momentum tensor, which satisfies conservation equation and the trace condition, and which is symmetric. Now you can ask, there is a similar object in the case of supersymmetry. So there is a similar supercurrent, which in the case of superconformal invariance allow me to write a second supercurrent, which is different from the previous one, but is conserved, is also conserved. Because in that case, it will mean that I have not only one supercharge which is conserved, but I have a second supercharge which is conserved. And this second supercharge has to do with n equal 1 superconformal symmetry. Well, the answer is yes. Well, this was actually in an old paper of mine in 1975, I think, where I wrote with Bruno Zumino a paper on the supercurrent and on the improved supercurrent multiplet. The statement is the following. Other than the canonical supercurrent j mu alpha, there is a second improved supercurrent, which I will call j mu improved, which has the property when supersymmetry is exact, it has the property that d mu j mu is zero. Well, this is the Ether supercurrent. But when superconformal symmetry is exact, not only Poincaré supersymmetry is exact, it will generate a second supercurrent which will be conserved as a consequence that J mu alpha is gamma traceless. So if you have a supercurrent which is conserved and which is gamma traceless, then you can show that there is a second supersymmetry and the theory is superconformal invariant. This second statement is the fermionic analogous of the traceless part of the stress tensor. The additional condition due to scale invariance and conformance invariant for the stress tensor was the trace being zero, and here is for the vector spin or current to be gamma traceless. So let me just show that the gamma traceless condition gives you a second supercurrent. I claim that if J is gamma traceless, then the following object, is the second supercurrent. So I claim that this current, which is x slash time j mu, is conserved if j mu is gamma traceless. Now you see that if I differentiate this object respect to e mu, I get one term when the derivative goes through x slash, which is zero because the mu j mu was zero. But the second term, when d mu it on x it give you exactly gamma mu j mu. And so the second current is conserved if j is gamma traceless. So there are two supercurrents which are conserved, so there are two supersymmetry charges which exist in this theory, and these two supersymmetry charges are precisely the Poincaré supersymmetry charge. Second charge is the one due to superconformal invariance. So superconformal invariance for the improved vector spinor current corresponds to the case that the vector spinor current improved is gamma traceless. And actually, not surprisingly, this is also, if you go to the machinery of superconformal primaries, is also the condition that the supercurrent is actually a superconformal primary, which goes in pair with the fact that this thing somehow is related by supersymmetry to the traceless condition of the energy momentum tensor. X slash is X rho gamma rho. Is this? It's like when you have a Dirac equation, gamma mu d mu, you call d slash. If I have gamma mu x mu, I call x slash. So you see that this object, if I differentiate and j is gamma traceless zero, and give so the superconformal current, which is usually called S alpha, is just the integral in D3X X slash J0. So it is a moment of the other, like in the case of the conformal group, where all the generators are obtaining by contracting the theta tensor with some polynomial indexes. Here is the analogous situation here. Actually, without saying about this gamma traceless, the fact that the superconformal algebra has this second current is already in the original paper of Bess and Zumino, which in fact they did the case not only of the Poincaré superalgebra, but of the entire superconformal algebra. Well, in the next lecture, I will show the particle multiplets which I've been discussing. The only thing I want to say is that how these multiplets are obtained. Well, you see this algebra here. Well, this is a fundamental observation of Salam Straddi at the very beginning of supersymmetry. You see, this algebra has an important property that the momentum p mu commute, so take this Bess-Zumino superalgebra, the momentum p mu commute with q and p. So I can always diagonalize this operator p mu. And in particular, if I think of this algebra realized on one particle state, p mu is the momentum of the particle. But so I can go in an eigenstate of the momentum. So I can take this algebra computed as an operator algebra on one particle state. So you have an object which has some momentum and some mass. And then using Lorentz symmetry, if the mass is non-zero, I can go always to a frame where P has only the zero component. Or if the particle has zero mass, I can go in the frame where the momentum, so in this case, m different from zero, I have a frame in which p mu is e zero, while in the case of zero mass, I have a frame where p mu can be taken as e zero zero e. So the point is that when P becomes a number, which is the case if I am in an eigenstate of the momentum, this algebra is no longer a real algebra. But in fact, it's an algebra of object which anticommute and we anticommute on numbers. this object which anti-commuting numbers we already encountered before, because this is nothing but the Clifford algebra. Because these Qs are like gamma matrices, and this P is a number here, so it's an algebra of the form QQ equal 1. And this is a Clifford algebra. So the representation on particle state of supersymmetry is given by spinor representation of a Clifford algebra, which has nothing to do with the Clifford algebra of the gamma matrices of the original Lorentz group. It has to do with this Clifford algebra here, which I should call rest frame Clifford algebra. So this Clifford algebra can be written with real combination of this Q would be gamma matrices, but if you like, with complex complex object, it would be creation and annihilation object operator. And since this Q are 2n in number, the Clifford algebra is actually a 4n, is a Clifford algebra for the group S of 4n. So if I have n extended supersymmetry and I have n Qs and n Q bars, this Clifford algebra here, which is the supersymmetry algebra in the rest frame, become the Clifford algebra of the group S of 4n for mass square different from zero, and S of 2n for mass square equals zero. For reason that I will explain, not now, but in the forthcoming lecture next. So you see, since this is a Clifford algebra, the multiplet of states will be a finite dimensional multiplet, because the Clifford algebra has only one irreducible representation, which is a spinor representation. So the multiplet will be the spinor representation, not of the Clifford algebra of the Lorentz Poincaré group, which I had before, but it will be in the spinor representation of this rest frame supersymmetry algebra. And since the spinor of SO4n has dimension 2 power 2n, and the spinor of SO2n have dimension 2 power n, you see immediately that this object will contain an equal number of bosons and fermions, because the bosons and fermions are actually obtained by acting on a vacuum with polynomial in the Qs. And for all the even Qs, you get the same number, because it's a spinor representation of this algebra. So the number of bosons will be 1 half 2 power 2n plus 1 half power 1 half power 2n in the massive case, and 1 half 2 power 2n the number of fermions. You have not to do any calculation to say that the bosons and fermions are equal numbers, because these are the order even term in the realization of this Clifford algebra in term of creation and annihilation operator on some Clifford vacuum. Well, because the boson, because from this construction, if I define a state which has Q alpha I equals zero, I obtain the representation of one particle state by applying Q bar alpha I to omega, and then going Q, and then you see that this polynomial, because of the anti-commutation relation QQ bar, is made by 2 power 2n object, of which the even power are bosons and the odd power are fermions, because they differ by half integer spin. So if one object is a fermion, the adjacent object is a boson, and vice versa. But has to do with the fact that this multiplet is actually the representation of this rest frame Clifford algebra. It's a spinor representation. A spinor representation of this rest frame Clifford algebra contains both bosons and fermions. It contains bosons and fermions in the odd power. And since this is the number of these states is given by the binomial polynomial, you get this number here in the case of massive particle, and this number here in the case of massless particle. So the total number of states is this, half of which is bosons and half of which are fermions. Question? Well, this actually is an analysis which is completely dimension independent. Because you see that what enter here doesn't enter, it enter only this number 4n or 2n. And this number 4n and 2n are related to the number of charges of the component spinor. So independently what the component, what the Lorentz spinor is, if I say that there are n charges in my algebra, then I get always this in any dimension. So this multiplet exists in any dimension. Of course, what happens is that if n is too large, this polynomial contains spin higher than 2. So this is how you see in this construction the fact that you have a bound in n, because if this n is too large, then the number of indices, the Helicity state will have Helicities bigger than 2 if n is actually bigger than 8. I will explain this to you in detail. But essentially, you will read all the multiplet using this rule. And I will show how using this rule you get, for instance, n equal 8 multiplet and all other multiplet. And I will also show you how this thing work in higher dimension. And I will specify the case of 6 dimension. But this is actually the way the Salamstra D related the supersymmetry algebra to the particle multiplet. This is a supersymmetry generalization of what is called the Wigner method of induced representation. Wigner method of induced representation for the Poincaré group. So let me just make one example. Take the massive case and take n equal 1. So Bezzomino Poincaré superalgebra with mass. How many states I get? I get 4 states, no? N equal 1, 2 power to n is 4. What is this 4? These 4 are 2 scalar and 1 fermion. 2 boson and 2 fermion. What is this? This is the chiral multiplet of Bezzomino. It's the massive chiral multiplet of Bezzomino. So simple. The massive chiral multiplet of Bezzomino is the building block of all massive representation. All the other are obtained by tensor product of this representation for n equal 1. For n bigger than 1, there will be similar analysis, and you will get the other multiplet. But in n equal 1, this number 4 is simply the chiral multiplet. It's a massive, is the smallest massive multiplet of the supersymmetry algebra. It's actually the multiplet that Bezzomino introduced in their first paper with a mass term. Okay, I think this is the end of my lecture.